Okay, Mr. Verhofstadt, thanks very much for a fascinating talk. I bet there are many people here who would like to ask you questions, but I cannot resist stepping in first. You have participated in many European councils. You have also, I guess, witnessed at least two intergovernmental conferences and two major treaty reforms. So you know firsthand how difficult it is for the treaties to change, for the European treaties to change. But a lot of the things that you discuss today, which I personally happen to agree with all of them, will require treaty change. It will require a package deal, a big idea, similar to what perhaps Jacques Delors did in the mid-1980s, the Single European Act. If you were to become the president of the European Commission, what would this idea be?
Well, the main point is that treaty change, not treaty change, we shall have treaty change in any way. Mr. Cameron shall help us for the treaty change because he is asking to transfer back a number of competences to Britain. So we shall have a discussion about that. So I always think, let's use the request of Cameron to open a discussion about the future of the European Union, because we need to have that that debate in the Union. When we did the previous convention, and this convention was based on the Declaration of Laeken, as you know, we didn't in this whole convention even talk 5 minutes about economic governance, you know? Because we said, oh, we have the Growth and Stability Pact, that's the basis of our economic policies, and that's it. And we didn't even discuss economic governance in the first in the Constitution and then later on in the Lisbon Treaty. It shall be necessary to talk about that because if you want to create a European Treasury, if you want to establish one bond market, what is absolutely necessary, we pay far too much interest rates in Europe because of a lack of such a market. I'm always comparing it with Japan. Japan has a debt of 240% now. 240, the double of Italy, so that means something, 240%. And they are paying the lowest interest rates. Lowest interest rates worldwide. Because, yeah, there is trust in that. There is one market in that. American market and bonds, how big it is. It is 10 trillion.
You think you can convince Mrs. Merkel to accept that?
Well, I think that it's possible. After the election, certainly it's possible. If we can show that such a system is also in the advantage of Germany. How do you want to be sure that countries like Greece, like a number of others, Italy, Spain, France even, are complying with reforms that are necessary in an economic and monetary union? Maybe the level of interest rates is the best way to comply. Saying if you reform your labor market, if you reform your pension system, if you establish a real competitive industry, then you can participate in such a system. If you don't do it, well, go to the markets to finance yourself. That should be a real system instrument to have these reforms. But that said, The main problem today in Europe is that we need, again, a European leadership and a commission who's using, as Delors did, his right of initiative. You know, you're all students here about European policies. You know, there is only one institution who have the right of initiative. It's the commission. Not even the parliament can do it. No, the European Council cannot do it. It is the commission. It's the commission who put on the table of council and parliament a legislative package to develop a European policy, to develop, for example, a European energy policy. We don't have it. I think that there are certainly in the Berlaymont enough ideas about it, but there is no legislative initiative about that that has been taken. Other example, economic governance. The Commission proposed and published a beautiful document about the need for an economic governance inside the Eurozone, but never translated it in a package and put it on the table of council. In my opinion, we have to return to the approach of the law. The law, for example, on internal market, he did a complete proposal. He put it on the table. A number of member states were against it. But at the end, he got 30% of what he proposed initially. Now we have a president of the commission who first of all phoned to Paris. No, I'm wrong. First of all phoned to Berlin. Then he phones to Paris. And then if he has the green light of both capitals, then maybe he shall do a proposal. And that proposal shall be 5% of the initial idea and of what is necessary. That is the problem. We need, again, a European leadership and a commission who is using the power that they have in the treaties. And not only on issues of economic policy, but also on issues of, for example, foreign affairs, of civil liberties, of migration, of energy, all competence on which we are completely absent for the moment.
Can I ask the audience perhaps to ask questions? If you can, keep your questions short, and we'll take them in groups of three or four, then giving a speaker the chance to respond quicker, right?
Mr. Dofter, it used to be received wisdom that you could only achieve regional integration between states if economic union preceded political union. Of course, the Zollverein, et cetera, was the best example of that. But is not one of the lessons of the euro the fact that you now, that received wisdom has been stood on its head, that you now need political union before you can achieve economic union, particularly in view of the large proportion taken by the nation state in the GDP of each country?
Thanks very much.
Thank you. Just briefly, I wanted to discuss what you mentioned in closing, the challenge of Eurosceptic parties, populism and nationalism. There was an Ipsos survey that came out last week which indicated that less than a third of the European population believe we're on the right track. Over two-thirds, as I mean, either believe that we need less Europe or a departure of Europe. You talked about a crisis in politics. I would say, is there not a crisis to a certain degree in leadership and direction? And how can we possibly look to rectify the structural challenges of Europe if we haven't got public support behind us? How can we challenge? How can we deal with that as a challenge?
Actually, my question is a follow-up to this question. You offered a very interesting, I think, analysis of how today's vote actually, pooling of sovereignty is more suitable for today's globalized world. But this is a message that doesn't come across, that doesn't penetrate basically domestic politics. Like if you take this example, the example of the UK, people that are, elites or leadership that is in favor of more political union simply fail to put their message across. So I was wondering if you think that there are any elites from the European Union level that could help this message for a stronger political union to be heard in those countries, and it links back to the question of lack of public support for something like a political union.
Maybe on the first point, I agree. I was very much impressed by a book. I think that it's an important book that has been written about this issue, and who was mainly saying, that phrase, that very famous phrase of one or other counselor of advisor of Bill Clinton, who said, "Is the economy stupid?" That was what he wrote on a wall when they discussed the second the re-election of Clinton. But that book says something different. It's politics stupid. That's a book of Why Nations Fail of Acemoglu and Robinson. It's a very interesting book because it's explaining it. No, it's not only about economics, it's about politics. And it is only a country with a free market system, with property rights, with this and that, in these conditions that you can create economic wealth. And I believe that more and more that we shall not emerge from the crisis if, first of all, we don't solve that political problem in Europe. And if we always have an hesitating leadership that is taking decisions too little and too late, if we could have a political union in Europe, then we should also on a fast track decide on a banking union, for example, where it takes now 6 years and maybe 7 years before it's in place. And the same is certainly true for other key sectors of the European economy. Well, Eurobonds, yeah, that's another example. Everybody knows that at the end we need it. Because it's very interesting to compare a little bit what happened in American history and in European history about the introduction of a currency. It's not the first time that a bloc introduced a currency. The Americans did it in the beginning of the 19th century. But first they did a number of other things. First, from a confederation, they became a federation in 1785 with the Convention of Philadelphia. And then, in 1790, they created the treasury. And then they introduced treasury certificates. It was a huge battle between Hamilton and Jefferson about it. And the outcome was that Jefferson, who was from North Virginia, received Washington, and that Hamilton received the treasury certificates. I think then always maybe we have to put the capital of Europe in Berlin, and then they give us the Eurobonds. Maybe that could be a good deal. That is then a Hamilton-Jefferson deal.
Don't say that.
Don't say that here. But okay, if that is the price to pay, why not on there? But I'm saying that to tell you that they did first a federation, then a treasury, then treasury certificates, and only then, after that, in the beginning of the 90s, they introduced the dollar. We Europeans are more intelligent. We start with the currency, and then after a time we say, oh shit, we don't have an economic union, we don't have a fiscal union, there is no bond market, there is no treasury, there is no this, there is no that. And we see that simply a loose coordination of policies is not enough. That's the topic of your book, if I understand it well, Professor. That all the policies, the 2020 strategy, the Lisbon strategy, that failed because there was no binding, and that were no binding policies. It was simply printing documents what we did. I remember it well. The only problem that you have as prime minister was in the Lisbon strategy is that it was printed and that you had to go to your parliament and to explain why you didn't reach the benchmarks. Because what was the Lisbon strategy? That is benchmarks, best practices, peer review, all beautiful words for nothing at all, for wind, for, I say, printing documents. That is it's mainly about. But that's not enough for a currency. If you have a monetary union, you need also an economic union. You need a common bond market, a common treasury, and so on. So politics politics is essential. If you have not the political will to do it, maybe I'm very clear about that. If you are not willing to do it, stop with the euro. I go back then to nation states who have their own currencies and competitive devaluations, like we have seen that in the past. Italy is the best example of that. And then it are the ordinary people who are paying the bill naturally. But okay, besides that, then you have to go back to these policies. But it's the one or the other. You cannot continue what we already do with Europe from decades to be a little bit pregnant. That's impossible to be a little bit pregnant. You're pregnant or not pregnant. It is a real political, economic, and fiscal union with everything what it means, or stop with it. And to continue to be in the middle like that, saying, but we are on the right we are on the right path, in the right direction. In the meanwhile, China, India, the US, and all the others are going at another higher speed than you. And then the second question, because I think the two questions together: public support, public opinion. Naturally, there is no public opinion for such an idea because there are no politicians saying that. How do you think that it works? That people wake up in the morning tired and so say, oh, we need more Europe. We need more Europe. It is a task of politicians and political parties to develop a vision about it, to tell it to people, and sometimes you have success and then you win elections and then you can go forward with these ideas or you lose. But if there are no political parties, no politicians, no political leadership in Europe who is saying that to the public opinion, how do you want that there is a public opinion for it? So that is what I'm not only a believer of supply as liberal, supply side economics, I think that also supply side politics exists. You need to offer something, to show a vision, to describe a vision, to offer something to a public opinion, and then you can have such policies. And the third thing is that I think that the crisis of today is helping in that. That's the reason why I'm always saying don't waste this crisis. Don't waste it, because it creates pressure now on the political leadership to go in that direction. What we shall not do is to make the failure to defend this Europe. No, we need another Europe. It can be a more integrated Europe, but it is not this Europe. It is not a Europe that is mainly governed in an intergovernmental way, with unanimity, too little, too late, only a monetary union, not all the other necessary unified policies, and so on. And it is also a Europe that transfer back a number of issues. What I don't support is a super state Europe with doing everything, with a huge bureaucracy. A number of things can be transferred back to the nation states, to the regional level, even to the local level, for me. There's also a big difference between Europe and the US about that. US, in my opinion, have also an internal market, but less regulation on the internal market. But they have more common policies. And we have the opposite. We have no common policies, but a huge amount of regulation on our markets. And so that's the shift to make. Less regulation, but more common policies. So that we can take advantage of a more integrated European Union.
So we'll collect a final round of questions. Please be brief, and then we'll give our speaker a chance.
I shall also be brief, yeah.
Given as a referendum is a constitutional requirement in Ireland in order to affect European treaty change, and also now in Britain it's a requirement for any treaty change, and also in Ireland, in France, in a lot of cases there's a requirement for a referendum for treaty change. Is it unrealistic to expect any treaty change in the next few decades? Will they ever pass?
Thank you. Yes, on the back.
So in your talk you talked quite a lot about, you made a persuasive case for European unity being necessary on the global stage, and you also said it's really important to engage with the elections that are taking place, the upcoming elections. But what's kind of missing is the connection between the two, because the Parliament wasn't mentioned once in your talk. You only mentioned it in the question period. What featured in your talk was the Council, which you made again a very convincing case. You made a very convincing case that this is a not very effective body, or at least a very odd body from a political perspective. And the Commission, which, unlike the Parliament, has no direct democratic mandate in the same way that an institution like the Parliament does, and yet the Commission has this right of initiative. Do you think the situation is right? What would you do about it?
Okay, can we... Yes?
Yeah, small question. I was asking when...
No,
the
just one. A short one.
Where's the need for a European army in the modern world?
Sorry, if we...
Why there is a need for a European...
Why?
Okay, thanks very much. Can we take one more?
Very, very quick one. Barroso is on record. Given that you're Belgium in the United Kingdom, Barroso said it would be extremely difficult, if not impossible, for Scotland to join the EU. This is one of the challenges I think the EU faces, is enlargement not just outside but from within. So I wonder if you have a view on whether this is a... whether this be a positive or negative development that kind of...
Why? I think that the arguments that Mr. Cameron is using to say Scotland cannot be independent should be very good arguments to say Britain never out of the European Union. No? Eh? Seems to me a connection between both of them. But mainly I think, and we think also, that's not only the case for Scotland, that it is a question of Britain and of the Scots and of the Brits and not of the European Union. I don't think that the European Union has to come in and to say, okay, we can recognize or not recognize. It's purely an internal affair. It's not to Europe to start to try to influence in one or another way or what's to happen in inside a country. Because Barroso did it. Eh? He intervened in this whole discussion. The second thing, second question about why an European army, I give some figures a few minutes ago about why it is necessary to do a European army. It's far more efficient than what we have today. We have 28 armies, and in my opinion, you can only have a common foreign policy if you have also common instruments. I was a member of the European Council at the moment that we discussed the war in Iraq, just before the Americans went into Iraq, in European Council. It was on the Spanish presidency. And this discussion has taken 40 seconds in European Council. We discussed Iraq in 40 seconds. Jacques Chirac saying, we shall not discuss it, we don't agree. In French, he said that, actually. And then Tony Blair responding, saying, yeah, I think, Jacques, you are right, we don't agree, so it's not necessary to talk about it. So, over. That was Iraq war, 40 seconds, in European Council. My point is that if you have a common diplomacy and a common army, it shall be necessary to have a common foreign policy. Because then it's not possible to say, we have different point of views. No, it shall be necessary to take position towards conflicts in the world. And that's the reason why I think it's absolutely necessary. I think also, I introduced with a Dutch, a Flemish writer, a new book, the Power of the Paradise is the name, I think, the Kracht van Paradise, the Power of the Paradise, a new book saying that we need again to invest in foreign policy, Europe. We are completely absent of foreign policy on the world stage. And that means also to have a common diplomacy and to be more credible on the issue of the military. And there, the only way forward is to have this European cooperation on military expenditures too. And that can be part of the NATO. I don't see an opposition between the North Atlantic Treaty Organization and such a policy. We can develop this European army as a pillar, one of the two pillars, the European pillar of NATO, of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. So there is no opposition. But certainly to save a huge amount of money and to be more effective with these policies, I think that also a European policy on military expenditures is absolutely needed and completely absent for the moment. My third point, I didn't talk about the European Parliament, maybe because I'm from the European Parliament. When I'm talking about a European Commission that takes the right of initiative, it's under control, naturally, of two chambers, I should say. One, the European Parliament representing the people, and one, the European Council, more and more becoming a type of Senate representing the member states. That is what we need. Even I'm in favor to give a right of initiative also to the Parliament, because I think that maybe that's the best way to push the European Commission forward in using their right by giving also the right to the other two institutions that matters. And finally, I think that the European Parliament has to receive all full powers like a normal parliament in any country in the world. That means also that it can decide on the resources of the Union. And you have to know, we have only competence on the expenditure side, no on the resources. That's like the British Parliament have no say on the revenue and taxation in Britain. No, that should be completely crazy. We created parliaments just because of the revenue of taxation. That's the origin of a parliamentary system. While we, on the European level, we have a full-fledged representation of the citizens by a European Parliament, but on the main issue, they have no competence. That's on the resources. And that means that we have now a system in which citizens are paying to member states. It are the member states who are paying to the European Union. That's the yearly budget and the multi-annual financial framework, and so on and so on, where we need, in fact, to have a direct link between the citizens and the European institutions. Because if you are not paying for, because people think that they don't pay for Europe. They think that they are only paying to the member state, and it's the member state who is paying them to Europe. It should be far better not to increase that, because I'm a liberal, so no new taxes, but that it goes directly from the European citizen to the European institution. Because if people are paying for something, they are interested in something, and they want to know what is happening with their money. Now, people are not interested. They think, oh, we are not, that doesn't affect us. It's that's a purely a question of the member states who are doing a fighting with each other every year on the budget. And that has to change. If you want a real European democracy, you need also a parliament, a democracy deciding on the resources. And saying to people, we want more resources. Or another party saying, we want less resources. Or we want to use this for this or for that. If you don't have that, you have not a real democracy. We are saying no taxation without representation, but you could also say the opposite. No representation without taxation, because what you are representing? If you don't in fact decide also on the resources of that that organization, what is Europe? And then finally, the question is, with all the systems that we have in a number of member states, is it possible to have still treaty changes because of the of a referendum? In principle, I'm in favor that in the future it should be, if we change the treaty, to have a European referendum. And not only nation by nation, but okay. It shall not be changed tomorrow in a European referendum, but at least in the next treaty, we have to introduce a system so that Europe, the integration of Europe cannot be blocked by one member state. What is the case now? If one member state says no, everything stops. And then you need a second referendum or a third referendum in Ireland before they say yes. Or the whole constitution is thrown away and you need to convert it in the Lisbon Treaty by taking out the constitutional elements. Because what we have taken out from the constitution and what is not in the Lisbon Treaty is the anthem and the flag. Fantastic. We did a great job. We take the constitution, we throw out the anthem and the flag, and then it's not longer necessary to put it to a referendum because there are no constitutional aspects anymore in the treaty. And that's the reasoning. That's the reason why the new Lisbon Treaty has not been, there was no referendum about it in France or in the Netherlands, where it was the constitution was under a referendum because there was an anthem in it and a flag in it. As we don't have a flag anymore since the Lisbon Treaty for the European Union. That it is also illustrating the complete lunatic way how we deal with this problem problems in Europe. So the proposal, and that is a proposal of Mr. Monti, Mario Monti, he has done a proposal already a few years ago, is that if we make a new treaty, at the end of the treaty, we have to put a clause in which we say that every country has to agree with that treaty by a decision of the parliament or by the decision in a referendum. If there is a no in that referendum, then we have to organize a second referendum with the key question, the existential question, do we want to stay in or are we going out? And then you solve that problem, because then it's clear, then it's the second referendum, it's about the question, we stay in or we go out. That's exactly the way how it happened in the US. When in the US they did the Convention of Philadelphia in 1785, there were 9 countries in favor of a federation and 4 countries against the federation, and we wanted to continue with the confederation. Well, what the Americans did was very simple. They said, from now on, it's not by unanimity that we run the US. We run it with a qualified majority of 9-4. And if 4 who didn't agree had a possibility to join or to leave. And all 4 of them joined the Federation. Even Rhode Island. It was also an island. Maybe it's not by coincidence. It was a rough island, Rhode Island, in the 18th century. So that's the way to deal with it. That is that we put in our new treaty system for the future a clause in which we say, yes, the people, by referendum, say yes or no to such a treaty. If somebody cannot accept it, then in a second referendum, they have to decide if they want to join or to leave. But that's a far better way to go forward with our project than what we are doing now. That's to wait until everybody agrees, unanimity. So it is the speed of the slowest member of the union that becomes the speed of the whole union, actually. That is what is happening. And the second thing what is happening, and it's hugely dramatic for the union, is that we have different speeds in the union. We have the Europe of the 9, the Europe of the 12, the Europe of the 15, the Europe of the 17, the Europe of Euro, the Europe of Schengen, the Europe of the patent, the opt-ins, the opt-outs, the earmarks, and so on. Very interesting for a professor.
Not even.
Really killing the union, and that has to stop. Or you are in, or you're out. Well, there are other ideas. The Spinelli Group have launched the idea to have membership, full membership, and associate membership. It's another one of the ideas. But that is what we need the fastest as possible. So there is a lot of work to do, and I think it's still interesting to learn about Europe and to follow courses about that. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Let me thank you again on behalf of the Jean Monnet Center of Excellence.